It's Jay Ramey here. Jay Ramey, attorney at law, up here at the Know Your Rights Bunker in Tulsa, Oklahoma, with another episode of Know Your Rights. Let's see, this is episode 16 called Stop and ID. So there's a lot of confusion about these stop and ID laws, and people, I see a lot of people get it entirely 100% wrong. Some people think what they call a stop and ID state. And Oklahoma is not a stop and ID state. And I'll talk more about that here in a minute. But there's these states that have these specific laws that mandate what kind of information you must provide to a police officer when he stops you, pursuant to having a reasonable, articulable suspicion to detain you. A police officer can ask you to stop and talk to him anytime you want. You don't have to. He can't detain you unless he has a reasonable, articulable suspicion that you have committed a crime. Some people think that in a stop and ID state, a police officer can just walk up to some guy walking down the road and demand that person produce ID, and if that person doesn't produce ID, he gets arrested and charged with a crime. That's not how it works. That's not. In fact, this was taken care of. This was decided in Brown versus Texas. We all learned this in law. This is one of those important law school cases because it came out before I went to law school, way before I went to law school. Came out in 1979, Brown versus Texas. And in this case, Texas had basically a stop and ID statute. And that statute in Texas said, it made it a criminal act for a person to refuse to give his name and address to an officer, and this is in quotes, who had lawfully stopped him and requested the information. Of course, lawfully. What's lawfully? What happened? The police in El Paso, Texas, they saw a guy in a alleyway walking away from another man. And based on that, they said, oh, that was suspicious. That was a high drug crime area. Very suspicious. And so we stopped him based on that. So this case is, you know, it's one of those interesting cases because the guy was only, he got a fine. He was arrested for not IDing himself. He refused to tell the police officers his name. He got arrested, went to court, eventually just got a fine of $45 plus court costs. And because of some procedural law in Texas, he didn't get to appeal this to the Texas Supreme Court. So he got, since the case was done and over with, as far as Texas law was concerned, he got to appeal it straight to the Supreme Court. But you know that cost a bundle of money. It's like I tell my clients all the time. You know, if you want to challenge something and you got a bundle of money, we'll appeal it to the Oklahoma Court of Criminal Appeals. And then if need be, we'll appeal it to the Supreme Court. But just appealing to the Oklahoma Court of Criminal Appeals is going to be a bundle of money, especially when you've just got a fine of $45. You know, I don't know who paid for the appeal, whether it doesn't say it's the ACLU. It has somebody's attorney's name. So sometimes the ACLU gets involved in cases like this, and they take the appeal up for no cost for the defendant, just because they want to make a case law, you know, controlling case law for the future. The state didn't even try to argue that a police officer can just demand ID from anyone. They said, oh, well, they had reasonable suspicion to stop him because the police officer said it was suspicious that he was in a high drug area and walking away from another guy. Yeah, the court said no. Let's see. Yeah, the state, this comes right out of the opinion. The state said the officers were justified in stopping the appellant because they had a reasonable, articulable suspicion that a crime was about to be committed. Yeah, the court said, yeah, right. The court says we require officers to have a reasonable suspicion based on objective facts that the individual is involved in criminal activity. You can't just say, oh, that was suspicious. You got to, the police have to point, they have to articulate, though, we say reasonable, articulable suspicion. They have to articulate facts that they saw that made them suspicious. They can't just say suspicious. Oh, he was in a high drug crime area. Anyway, so what the court said, and they didn't say the statute of, this Texas statute was unconstitutional because the statute says they can stop somebody lawfully. Well, that's the whole point. It's unlawful to stop somebody unless you got reasonable, articulable suspicion that they're committing a crime. Okay, so the court overturned, what's his name? Mr. Brown. They overturned Mr. Brown's $45 fine. So I guess he got his $45 back plus his court costs. But this just tells you the police cannot just march up to anybody out on the street and demand ID. All right? So that takes us to 25 years later. If I did the math right, I'd become an attorney because I'm good at math. We had the big Heibel case, and I was an attorney when this came out. I'd have been an attorney for several years. And that was, it was decided in 2004. In the Heibel case, we had another Nevada, it started out in Nevada, and we had a Nevada statute. And in researching, getting ready to make this video, what I have found is that most of these stop and ID statutes, they don't carry a criminal penalty. Basically, the statute is just reaffirming what Terry has said. And Terry is a case that all attorneys know. Some of you out there may have heard it. It was decided back, I believe, in the 60s. Where it came up with this, what I was just talking about before, reasonable, articulable suspicion. The police can ever since Terry was decided, because before Terry, we thought we had to have probable cause to seize a person. That's the seizure of a person. If the police stop you, if they stop you, that is the seizure of a person. We had always thought before Terry, and that was the argument in Terry, that the police didn't have probable cause to detain Terry. Well, no, back in Terry, the Supreme Court said all police need to detain someone, temporarily detain them while they see what's going on, is reasonable, articulable suspicion, all right? So, that's what most of these statutes, the stop and ID statutes are. They just are restating Terry, what Terry says. And the Nevada law says any peace officer... Again, this is the stop and ID law out of Nevada. Well, again, it's more than a stop and ID. I guess the stop and ID is just part of it. It's all restating Terry. And again, not all states have statutes like this. Oklahoma does not have statutes like this. Now, I first started practicing law in Kansas. They got a lot of these statutes where they restate Terry, they restate Miranda. By statute, which I don't know why they do this because it's not required because we know what the law is from the court case, but they just restate it and they put it in a statute, okay? So that's what Nevada has done. It says, any peace officer may detain any person whom the officer encounters under circumstances which reasonably indicate that the person has committed, is committing, or is about to commit a crime. Again, that's right out of Terry. They skip section 2 and then they go to section 3. The officer may detain the person pursuant to this section only to ascertain his identity and the suspicious circumstances surrounding his presence abroad. It's kind of weird language. Any person so detained shall identify himself, but may not be compelled to answer any other inquiry of any peace officer. So let me state that again. Any person so detained shall identify himself, but may not be compelled to answer any other inquiry of any peace officer. I mean, that's standard Miranda stuff, and that also comes out of Terry, too, where Terry talks about a police officer can stop and detain someone, ask them questions, but they're not compelled to answer. Well, that's, we kind of get into this, and I'll talk about that here more in a minute. But also Miranda and all that. You're not Fifth Amendment, Sixth Amendment right. Your Fifth Amendment right to remain silent, your Sixth Amendment right to counsel. You don't have to answer any questions. So this is saying, the person shall detain them, the person detained shall identify himself, but may not be compelled to answer any other questions, all right? And then the Supreme Court also notes that the Nevada Supreme Court had interpreted this statute that identifying yourself means you have to give a first and last name. No requirement to give an address, social security number, date of birth, no requirement to give a physical ID. Now, if you're driving a car, you're going to have to give your driver's licenses. You're gonna have to identify yourself and turn over a driver's license if you're driving. I know that's. I've been accused of being a sovereign citizen, and I've seen some comments. I'll talk about those in another episode. But yeah, they accuse me of being a sovereign citizen. I'm not a sovereign citizen. None of this I talk about is sovereign citizen crap. Now, I know sovereign citizens think you don't have to have a driver's license, and since you don't have to have a driver's license, you certainly don't have to turn it over to the police. If you get pulled over while you're driving a car because the police officer has reasonable suspicion that you violated some kind of traffic law, you have to give them your driver's license, all right? So if you're driving a car, you got to give them a driver's license to get pulled over. This statute says, you know, if the person stopped because the police reasonably think he's committing a crime, he shall identify himself, and the Supreme Court of Nevada said that means you got to give him a first and last name. So here's the United States Supreme Court in the Heibel case, quoting the Nevada Supreme Court, the Nevada Supreme Court had determined this in another case. The suspect is not required to provide private details about his background, but merely to state his name to an officer when reasonable suspicion exists. Well, hell, what does that mean? His name, does that mean first name, middle name, last name? I don't know. You know, I think a reasonable interpretation of that is your first and last name. Okay. So some of the issues in Heibel were because in Terry, you know, again, that case from a long time ago that set up this scheme where police can detain you on less than probable cause, reasonable suspicion. One of the concurring justices in the Terry case said the police can ask the person any question they want. They can detain him, ask him any questions. He doesn't have to answer any is what a concurring justice had said in that case. And then, of course, the Fifth Amendment. There was the Fifth Amendment issue. Well, you don't have to answer any questions because the Fifth Amendment right to not incriminate yourself. Well, the court made a new rule, said, okay, we've said before that you aren't required to answer any questions. Well, first and last name, well, it doesn't even say first and last name, I guess. They just said name is reasonable. And then they left open the issue of self-incrimination. They said Mr. Heibel did not bring up anywhere in the court record that giving his name would have incriminated him. But they left it open in this case. They did not make a decision whether in some circumstance someone giving their name could incriminate themselves. And that's this a pretty, you know, I meant to say in this, the Brown case, I forgot to say this, Texas versus Brown. Folks, this was unanimous Supreme Court, all 9 justices. There was no justice that said a police officer can just march up to you on the street and demand you give ID. Okay, 9 justices, and again, I'm talking about the Brown versus Texas case from 1979. All justices agreed on this one. So, 9 justices agree, you know that you're getting a good interpretation of the United States Constitution as far as a person's rights, against the government and for the people, if you get 9 justices to agree. In the Heibel case, and again, I don't know if I'm pronouncing that right. I don't even know if I said it right at the beginning when I start talking about it. It's Heibel versus 6th Judicial District Court of Nevada, Humboldt County. Okay. Anyway, in the Heibel case, it was a 5-4 decision. The dissenting justices, their concern was, well, we have said before that the police can detain you in a Terry stop. They can detain you and ask questions, but you're not obligated to answer. You're not obligated to answer anything. And then they also talked about, you know, Miranda. And I run on this sometimes too in cases. Mainly civil cases. And when I do civil discovery, like when the police, when we do forfeiture cases, the police have taken money. It's usually money, other property. Then they hit you with all these what's called civil discovery. It's all different than a criminal case. And they're asking all these questions. And I, at the beginning of the case, my answers are my client's asserting his Fifth Amendment. Well, you got to tell us why. Why? If I tell you why he's asserting his Fifth Amendment, then what's the point of it all? Anyway, that was some of the dissenting justices' problems in this case. They said it's always could be a Fifth Amendment problem to have to give a police officer your name, and you shouldn't have to prove that it would be incriminating. Anyway, but that's what they said. Okay. So let's talk about Oklahoma, and then we'll talk about some other states. Okay, I forgot one major thing to talk about when I was talking about the Hybel case. Like I said, Nevada had this stop an IED law. I mean, it's basically, it's Terry restated, put into a statute, and put in Nevada law. Only one part of it is about you got to provide your name to the police upon them asking you for it. But the thing is, that statute does not have a penalty to it. It does not say, well, if you don't provide your name, you're looking at a fine of $100 or you're looking at a year in jail. There's no penalty to it. So what they did in Nevada, and I assume they still do, then they revert back to the obstructing an officer statute. And I'm going to talk about that here in Oklahoma in just a minute. So because Hybel, and again, I don't know if I'm pronouncing that name right. But anyway, Larry Dudley Hybel. Because he did not provide his name, they charged him with obstructing an officer for, again, the Supreme Court's got this in quotes, willfully resisting, delaying, or obstructing a public officer and discharging or attempting to discharge his legal duty of his office. I'm sorry, to discharge any legal duty of his office. So, again, the stop an ID statute does not have a penalty, so they revert back to the general obstructing law in Nevada, and that's what Hybel was convicted of, obstructing an officer because he did not provide his name when asked by the police officer. Oh, and another thing I forgot to mention was the court found in the facts of this case that there was reasonable articulable suspicion for the police to, I guess it was one deputy showed up. I don't know if any other showed up. The court right at the beginning found there was reasonable articulable suspicion for the police officer to detain Hybel to investigate because they thought a domestic violence situation had gone on. I'm not going to go into all the facts. People complain my videos are too long anyway. So now let's talk about Oklahoma. All right, before we talk about Oklahoma, one more thing about Hybel that I forgot. Again, I'm trying to get, people complain the whole videos are too long, so I'm trying to rush to them, but that's why I make these videos. Let's talk about it. Let's talk about everything. And Hybel, again, the Supreme Court said, based on what the Nevada Supreme Court says, you only have to give it your name, presumably your first and last name. There was no decision in Hybel. Do you have to give your address, your date of birth, anything else? So that's left open. Again, that's left open, according to the Supreme Court in the Hybel case. We don't know if you have to provide all that. So Oklahoma has no stop an ID statute. What we have is obstructing a public officer. I've seen this obstructing statute in Oklahoma used many times in my career, 20 years of practicing law, to charge someone with a crime who will not give their name, at least their name, because we don't know in Oklahoma what you have to give. And again, Hybel only says first and last name. What, I didn't even say that. It says name, which I assume is first and last name, but the Hybel case does not really get into that. Anyway, the Oklahoma law is so general. It's not only used to charge people with not giving their name to the cops, but all kinds of stuff. This is 21 OS section 540. Any person who willfully delays or obstructs any public officer in the discharge or attempt to discharge any duty of his or her office is guilty of a misdemeanor. And again, that sounds a lot like the obstructing officer in the obstructing of an officer statute that we heard in the Hybel case out of Nevada. So that's it, Oklahoma. And for what it's worth, our legislature here in Oklahoma saw all these videos of people getting arrested for recording police. So they added this sentence that's not relevant to anything here, but it says, nothing in this section shall preclude a person from recording activity of law enforcement in a public area as long as the recording activity does not delay or obstruct the law enforcement agent in his or her duty. Anyway, that's the law. That's what you will be charged with in Oklahoma if you do not at least provide a first and last name. Maybe a date of birth. I don't know. You're not required to carry physical ID. You never require to carry physical ID. Again, if you're in your car, driving your car, you got to have a driver's license, and you got to give that to the police officer who pulls you over. You don't have to have physical ID, but in Oklahoma, what I meant to say at the beginning of all this, we have no case law in Oklahoma regarding any of this. What do you have to provide? Or do you have to provide any? Do you even have to provide a name? I'm telling you, at the trial court level, I've had people charged with this, charged with obstructing an officer for not giving at least their name, sometimes their driver's license. Anyway, and it's usually involved with, they're charged with a whole bunch of other stuff, so it's the least their concerns. And I guess I should go ahead and say this. Like I said in that Brown case where the guy only got a $40 fine and appealed all the way to the Supreme Court, I tell all my clients, I'm telling you all out there in Oklahoma, if you want to fight this all the way and you want to appeal it to the Oklahoma Court of Criminal Appeals, I'll go all the way. But it's going to cost a bundle of money where you might just be looking at, you might just be looking at them giving you a fine, a short deferred thing, if that's all you're charged with. Again, usually somebody's charged with obstructing while they're charged with something else, more serious stuff. But I would love to do an appeal on this. Somebody needs to do an appeal one day, but the bad part of it is our Court of Criminal Appeals here in Oklahoma, they're eager to support the state and the police, so I don't know that we'd get a very good decision. They may say you have to provide your first name, last name, middle name, address, date of birth, social security number, your firstborn child's name. I mean, who knows? Who knows what they'd say? But we don't have any clarification on this law in Oklahoma. So, one more time. If you live in Oklahoma, you get arrested for obstruction, for not giving your first and last name to a police officer, come hire me. We'll go to the trial court. We got to take it to trial and lose, and then you could get some time in jail, and then we'll appeal it all the way to the Court of Criminal Appeals. That's probably why it's never been appealed in Oklahoma, because in Oklahoma, we don't have what they call interlocutory appeals, where you can appeal before you go to trial. In Oklahoma, you have to go to trial and lose, and then end up going to jail, maybe just get a fine. But you could end up going to jail, and most people, they don't want to risk it and all that. There's a list that I was looking at of stop and ID states, and I pulled the statutes for just some of them. I think there's... Now I forgot. I should have written it down. I was looking it up just before I started this video. Now I forgot. There's several. I think less than half of the states are what they call stop and ID states, where they actually have a statute mandating what you must give. Okay, so this is Colorado. Stopping of suspect. A peace officer may stop any person who he reasonably suspects is committing, has committed, or is about to commit a crime, which, again, that's right out of Terry. That's the law right out of Terry. And may require him to give his name and address, identification if available, and an explanation of his actions. Okay, they can't require you to give anything. I mean, from Heibel and Brown and all these other, and all the Miranda, everything, Terry, you can't require an explanation. A police officer cannot require any explanation of anything by a person he stops. The person can keep their mouth shut. All we know from Heibel is you have to give a name, first and last name. So, this says his name and address. Well, what if you don't give an address? And then they convict you of this, then you can appeal to the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court can expand on Heibel. You have to give an address. I don't know. That's what Colorado says. Then it goes on to say, peace officers shall not require any person who is stopped pursuant to this section to produce or divulge such person's social security number. So at least they stop a social security number. The stopping shall not constitute an arrest. Okay, so that's what Colorado says. And again, there's no penalty to it, so I'm assuming what they do in Colorado, if you don't do this, they revert back to the obstructing an officer statute, and then they charge you and prosecute you for that. But we're going to talk about an interesting situation out of Wisconsin here in just a minute. So there's Colorado. So let's look at, I pulled Kansas because I'm licensed to practice law in Kansas, and actually my first 5 years of practicing law were in Kansas. I don't ever remember this coming up. Kansas has a lot of these statutes where they take known law, known case law, Supreme Court law, like Heibel and Terry and Miranda, and then they put it in a statute. So this statute out of Kansas says, stopping a suspect. One, subparagraph one, without making an arrest, a law enforcement officer may stop any person in a public place whom such officer reasonably suspects is committing, has committed, in the same language, has committed or is about to commit a crime. Again, that's right out of Terry. That's right out of Terry, the case from the 60s, I believe. You know, it's going to be 1959 when they decide that. Someone's going, oh, we don't know what he's talking about. He's an idiot. You know, you people with that crap. Just, I don't care. I'm pretty sure it was from the 60s, though. Okay, so has committed, is about to commit a crime, and may demand of the... I'm sorry. I need to get some reading glasses. Look how small this type is. And may demand of the name, address of such suspect, and an explanation of such suspect's actions. Again, a police officer can demand an explanation all he wants. You cannot require that. He can demand it all he wants. That cannot be required. You don't have to say nothing. All we know from Heibel is, unless you can show that your name might be incriminating, what we know from Heibel is all you have to provide is a name. So this says may demand of the name, address, and of the suspect an explanation. So, name, we know from Heibel, you have to give your name. Do you have to give your address? I don't know. Someone's going to have to appeal that to the Supreme Court. We're going to have to get them to expand on the Heibel decision. You have to give an address. But if you don't want to get charged with obstruction in Kansas, you probably want to give your name and address. If you're being detained, number one, you have to be detained. Number two, you have to be legally detained. And if you don't think you're being legally detained, you better be right about that. Of course, I've talked about, in some of my other videos, I've talked about what it takes to detain you. Okay, so there's Kansas. Let's look at one more. Alabama. I pulled Alabama because it was the first on the list. It was the state that was first on the list. It starts with an A. A sheriff or other officer acting as a sheriff, his deputy, or any constable acting within their respective counties, any marshal, blah, 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 policeman, blah, blah, it goes on and on. Highway patrol may stop any person abroad, I love that, abroad, in a public place whom he reasonably suspects is committing, has committed, or is about to commit a felony or other public offense, and may demand of him his name, address, and here we go, we got an explanation of his actions. Again, he can demand that all he wants. If you've watched all my other videos, you know what to say. I got nothing to say, I need to talk to an attorney. But you may be able to give your name and address. Well, now what if he comes up to your porch? Because he's suspecting you of a crime that you've committed in your house. He comes on your porch and demands your name. Well, this says, you know, a person abroad in a public place. So I don't know, whether you have to, again, if he knows your house, he can figure out your name probably. But I don't know. That's a question that, you know, maybe there's a case on Alabama. I don't know. Okay, let's get to this last interesting case that I found. So Wisconsin, is it Wisconsin? Ugh, again, I got to get some reading glasses. Yes, this was a case out of Wisconsin from 1995. I looked it up. It's still good law. It hadn't been overturned. This is actually a civil case where the plaintiff, the guy who got arrested, sued the police officers for arresting him because they said there was no probable cause to arrest him. And it's an interesting case because Wisconsin has a stop and ID law, but the obstruction law is much different. So the law in Wisconsin was in 1995. I don't know if, you know, who knows? Wisconsin got to change their law by now. I noticed that some states, like California, used to have a stop and ID law, and I guess they repealed it because they're not on that list of having the stop and ID statute. So evidently, California has repealed their law. Anyway, so Wisconsin law provides that a police officer can temporary questioning without an arrest. Oh, I'm sorry, that's the title. Temporary questioning without arrest. After having identified himself or herself as a law enforcement officer, A law enforcement officer may stop a person in a public place. Again, there we go with the public place. What if it's on your front porch? That's, you know, that's an, or they come into your house. You know, they got a warrant, or you invited them. We, of course, we know we never invite them in. But that's an interesting question. But that doesn't matter here. May stop a person in a public place for a reasonable period of time when the officer reasonably suspects that such person is committing, is about to commit, or has committed a crime. Again, that's right out of Terry. And may demand the name and address of the person and an explanation of the person's conduct. Such detention and temporary questioning shall be conducted in the vicinity where the person was stopped. Again, they can demand an explanation, but you cannot be prosecuted, charged with a crime for not giving an explanation of your actions. You do not have to answer any questions of the police. I mean, that's still the law. All we know from the Hybel case is that they can, is you have to give your name. But not in Wisconsin, because, okay, that's their stop. Well, it's not really their stop and ID law. It's their Terry law. It's the United States. It's the United States Supreme Court Terry law holding put into the statute in Wisconsin. So again, let's remember what happened to Hybel. Hybel violated that statute, but it didn't carry a penalty, so they charged him with the obstructing. Well, the thing is, in Wisconsin, their obstructing law is not so wide open, and you know, such open language. It's very detailed. So the obstructing law in Wisconsin states, there's some introductory part to it, but then it says, obstructs includes, without limitation, knowingly giving false information to the officer, or knowingly placing physical evidence with intent to mislead the officer in the performance of his or her duty, including the service of any summons or civil process. We compare that to the Oklahoma obstructing law, which is so broad and wide open, it can mean anything that either a jury decides when you go to court, and an appellate court decides when it goes up on appeal. So Oklahoma is any person who willfully delays or obstructs any police officer in the performance of his duty. Well, that's more wide open than giving false information or placing physical evidence with intent to mislead from Wisconsin. So what the court in this case said, they said the police had reasonable suspicion to stop the guy and question him, but he's not required to answer any of the questions, including giving his name, because that's not giving false information. That's what the police officers were arguing in this case, or their attorney was. They were arguing, well, he, by not giving his name, that's false information. Well, how's that false information? So that was their argument, that he violated that obstructing statute. The court said, no, this was an illegal arrest, because you cannot, well, the court said it was a legal arrest, but they gave him qualified immunity. That's a whole nother topic for it. So basically, this Wisconsin court said it was an illegal arrest, but the police officers were off the hook because it was qualified immunity. That's something else for another time. What the court said was this was an illegal arrest because he did not violate the statute. You cannot be compelled to give your name because the obstructing statute does not cover you refusing to give your name. All right, folks, that is it. I know I've talked a long time. A lot of people complain my videos go too long. I like to be able to go in depth on this, talk about all these different cases. I mean, this is only, folks, there's other cases that I could have talked about. I could talk about 5, 6, 7 more, you know. Hopefully this video didn't go too far over, too long, over 30 minutes. Anyway, so let's get out of here. And remember, folks, remember, when you're out on the street, driving in your car, and you have a police encounter, never, never waive your sacred constitutional rights when having a police encounter. Always, always assert those rights. And if you don't know what they are, go back and watch my video number one, episode one. Episode 1 through 4 are, give it all to you, but episode 1 especially. Tell you the 3 things you need to know about your rights, the 3 most important thing. If you got those 3 things down, you're ready for a police encounter. All right, never waive your constitutional rights when having a police encounter. All right, let's get out of here. I'll try to make another video. I know I haven't made a video in a long time, so I'll try to make another video soon. All right, folks, we'll talk to you guys later. I woke up in a Soho store where a policeman knew my name. He said, "You can't go to sleep at home."